My name is Lara, and this is my story. I was born in Denver, Colorado in 1982. My mom was a drug addicted alcoholic stripper, and I was supposed to be aborted, but God saved my life, and so she kind of turned her life over to God at that time. My father actually was murdered when I was 3. And so she went through a time of, you know, DTs, and then she totally sold herself out for the Lord. And then I had a series of stepdads that, you know, were also alcoholics. And, you know, one of them was not, he was mentally and emotionally abusive. He would say really strange things. The next stepdad after him was just very absent in our lives, didn't really have a lot to, you know, put towards our lives. And so I, you know, kept, I guess, looking for my father in men and relationships and looking for love in all the wrong places. So that just continued on. I wouldn't say I was really had any addiction problems until later on in my life, but I was definitely addicted to love, trying to find someone to love me. I would run away from home a lot to be with these grown random men. All of the men I dated were adults, even though I was a child. So yeah, I didn't have a lot of understanding as far as what love was supposed to look like. You know, my mom though was so in love with Jesus, you know, and so like everything I ever knew about God was through her. And you know, she, every chance she got, she would teach us the parables, and you know, like, so I knew the word even though I had never actually read the Bible. And it was like all of my relationship with God had to be filtered through my mother, you know. So when she was diagnosed with emphysema, it was kind of like crazy because she was that one person in our lives that said the words, "I'm proud of you," even when we weren't doing anything worthy of that, or just saw the good in us even when things weren't good, you know. So the idea of losing her was terrifying because it meant that we had no fallback, nobody to lean on. We would become orphans. You know, I was one of 5 kids. So the idea of losing our fallback plan, which was our mom, was terrifying. She was diagnosed with emphysema, and she started passing away and was passed away within 2 years of her diagnosis. And that was a really hard time because she was this amazingly brilliant woman who had a passion for Jesus and conversation, and would sit around the table and drink coffee and smoke cigarettes. And, you know, not that I'm proud about the cigarettes, but that's what we did. And we would laugh and we would talk. And so when she started to pass, she was on hospice. And so she was on pain medications, and I would go visit her, and I would just be longing for these conversations, and she'd be nodding out the whole time. And by then I had already been, you know, taking a pill here, pain pill there, you know. After she died in 2009, I just kind of fell apart. It's like one big addiction blur. That went on for probably a year or so, and then I felt like my daughter, who at the time she was 3, she had just turned 3 after my mom died, and she was microwaving hot dogs and eating spoonfuls of peanut butter because I was asleep. I couldn't take care of her. I didn't care really. Dora the Explorer was on all the time, filthy diapers, and I don't know, I just decided, I ran out of pills is what happened. And I went through horrible withdrawals. And my sister called the ambulance, and you know, I went down there, and the doctor asked me, "Are you addicted?" And I was like, "Well, yeah." So that's when, you know, my doctor said he wouldn't be my doctor anymore, and the hospital said there wasn't anything they could do for me, and so I got clean on my own. But there's that scripture in Matthew that says, the demons leave you and it goes out into the wilderness, and out there it thinks to itself, I think I'll go back to the place I left, and finding it swept in order and brings back seven more like itself. My addiction came back like that because I didn't fill up the empty space with God and the Holy Spirit. I wanted to fill it up with something. And so before you know it, I call it dry sober. That's what I tell my girls, where you're sober, but you don't want to be. Like, you feel like there's no life worth living if you're not getting high. That's dry sober. And that's how I was. I was always looking at someone's prescription bottle. If someone had some, I was like, hey, you want to help me out with some of those? You know? And it just became my, you know, used into poverty. My daughter, I had to sign over my rights to her as a mother to my sister because I knew she wasn't safe with me. She was 5. I had just had Elijah, my son. And so they're 5 years apart. I got pregnant with him when it was the worst possible time, you know. I was in an active addiction. I was trying to go to school. I was homeless. So it was a mess. So he ended up being drugged, you know, right beside me through all of my escapades. In the meantime, I bounced from family member to family member and couch to couch. We'd spent lots of nights in cars. And one of the things that I did to pay for my pain pills, because, you know, by then I was buying them on the street and getting a prescription. And I used to take my kids out and panhandle with them, tell them, you know, because I was a weekend warrior mom for my daughter. And how we would spend our weekends was, we'd go stand out on the corner in blizzards with signs about being homeless and whatnot, so that they would, you know, people on their heartstrings and would give us money, and I would go buy my pills. And yeah, so in 2015, I ended up, my grandma, who I was taking care of on hospice, passed away. And by then, my addiction was out of control. I was hook, line, and sinker. You know the scripture that says, you are a slave to whatever controls you. I was a slave to my pills. And every waking moment of my life was dedicated to the high. And it wasn't even about the high by then. It was about not being sick. So when people ask you, why do you do these things? We don't want to. We have no choice. It's as much as eating or drinking water by then. And you have to survive. And so I was a monster of a mom when I wasn't high. And abusive, and you know, I used to yell and scream at Elijah and as a monster, and Bella too, and hit them. And so in 2015, my sister was like, you know, this, you need help. And she told me about this place called House of Promise in Olathe, Colorado, and it's a faith-based program. It's a Teen Challenge spinoff, but it's for women and women with children. I felt like in order for me to stay sober and pursue this path with Jesus, because at House of Promise, I fell in love with God. And I read my Bible for the first time. And I read my Bible through that Life Recovery Bible. And I had never read a Bible before. You know, I had always known what I knew from my mom. And so I had a Life Recovery Bible, and someone had given it to me as a gift. And the cool thing about it is that you open to the first page and it says step one, and then it gives you this little reading and it tells you what to read, and at the bottom it says what page to turn to next. So I just followed the bouncing ball all the way through it, and by the time I was done with it, it was, you know, torn and battered and well used like a good Bible. And God found me there. And woke up my whole life and I had never known love or peace or kindness the way that I found it then. And I knew that I found the drug worth being addicted to. And I decided that I was gonna spend the rest of my life addicted to Jesus. And set as many people free as I could. But when we got back, I had no money, I had no help. There, you know, the ministry was dead in the water. And so I really was heartbroken because I'm thinking, I believed you. Like, I trusted in your scriptures about your children won't beg for bread, and here we are with no place to go. And I had enough money to pay for one more night in a hotel room, and I spent that whole night calling around for homeless shelters, and I finally got a hold of Hope House in McAllister. And so they got me there, I checked in, and in January of 2 years ago, and we stayed there for 8 months. And the whole time I lived there, I felt like God really was revealing my purpose, because I was meeting all these women just like me and with stories so familiar to mine, and mental illnesses they're struggling through like mine. And just, I was like, duh, you know, right? He was turning my mess into my message. And I finally realized all along that God gives us our message in our life, in our experience, and most of all, our testimony. And I just found myself there, I guess. And I started asking Tina, the ministry coordinator, hey, you know you want to hire me, right? And she was like, I'm telling you right now, that's not going to happen. And I'm like, you'll see, it's going to happen. So that's how I got there. I just wouldn't stop asking for a job. So finally she was like, okay, fine. We'll see. Now I work 3 to 11 shifts, so I spend a lot of time with the ladies. And I teach the live recoveries Bible study on Thursdays. I never had a house. We never had a home. Either my mom had to marry a guy or, you know, whatever the case may be. And so one of the biggest things that I love about Hope House is this transitional housing, because A, you get transitioned into this housing and it's a nice little house, and you know, the rent is very cheap, and then they work with you. It's not like they just kick you out and they expect you to make it. They ask you what your goals are, which mine is to buy a house. I want to give my children the stability I never had. And so they took that into consideration, and they're fighting me against myself for me, you know? And I know that sounds like a, you know, like it doesn't make any sense, but it's true. It's, you know, I meet with the financial people, you know, Joey's the financial guy, and we talk about, you know, my spending habits and how we strategize how to fix it, and so that the long game is that I can achieve the dreams that I want. And so I think that's incredible. And in all the time that I've been in programs or any of that, I think that's the thing that makes Shared Blessings and Hope House different, is that they don't just leave you to sink or swim. They teach you how to swim so that you can swim by yourself. And that's huge for women coming out of these life situations, you know, me included. I think that people have it in their minds that everyone who comes into Hope House is either, you know, a drug addict or or an alcoholic or have done some horrible thing, or, you know, but sometimes it's just circumstance. Some, you know, like for me, for instance, I have Jesus. I love Jesus. I'm not without God, and I'm not there because of drugs. I was there because that's just the series of events that led me there. So I feel like giving to that program, you really are helping the whole of McAllister, because a lot of these people can't get out of where they're at because there's no other options. If you give them other options, they can take those other options, and then they raise well-adjusted children who become well-adjusted adults, and then as a whole, you're making McAllister a good place to be. You know that little thing that lives inside of you, you can't make stop or go away, or you know you're good at? That's the thing that God knit together in you, that He has every intention of filtering into something incredible. So every moment of your life isn't figuring it out to the end game. Every step you take in life is just making the next right choice. And if you just honor the gift you already have and you let it grow and you choose God first, there's no limit to what God can change you into and see in you. And, you know, don't allow the enemy to lie to you and convince you that you're not worth fighting for. And I think the only one who needs to fight the hardest for our life is us. Because we're the ones that give up on ourselves the easiest. And your love's broken things just the way they are. Peace by peace, He's creating. It's a
story to tell.